It's my great pleasure to introduce the feature speaker today, Dr. Olga Popovicheva, who's a leading scientist at Moscow State University. I met Olga in the lobby of a hotel in Moscow. About 2 years ago, I was going for meetings with the World Bank, and we had made contact and email over these kinds of issues before. And as these things tend to happen, there was just this opportunity to have a meeting. So as I'm leaving, I'm telling my wife, yes, I'm going to meet a woman named Olga in a hotel in Moscow. And she's a bright light leading scientist. And yeah, my wife said, uh-huh. And so I'm very pleased that about 2 years later, I guess, after the launch of FlareNet, and of course, Olga was very helpful in bringing that forward and providing some letters of support on her end, that we've been able to bring her here to Canada. She's been working with us quite closely in the lab this week, sharing our expertise on particulate sampling. And her interest that she's going to talk about in particular is looking at the receptor measurements in Arctic regions and connecting this back to where it's coming from. And so she's got really interesting ideas about maybe fingerprinting and how we might carry this forward in the coming years. But to give a taste of what we might be able to do and what's kind of out there and possible, I think she's going to tell some interesting tales of her exploits in the high seas of the Arctic. So, Olga, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Matt, for the introduction. So Matt already so many times referenced to my talk, so I'm responsible now to almost resolve many, many questions, so I would like to make this one. So I will tell you about observation of black carbon. So you are well, very much motivated now about. But whatever, I want to pay, first of all, your attention on the real, let's say, measurements, even how we can somehow to increase our knowledge about the black carbon, about Arctic pollution, and whatever about emission and anthropogenous impact on climate in general. And so I will tell now just, I will tell about black carbon. So black carbon, you know, that's a part of aerosol, which absorbs light, first of all. It is short-living climate forcer, which has an amplified effect on climate, you know, already many times, reduced probably surface albedo, enhanced snow melting. It is general words. So let's look on the real, let's say, concentrations of black carbon and estimate if there is impact or really anthropogenous impact or not. So the first of all, we have to collect data. So long time gap in aerosol measurements in Russia Arctic just now strongly limit estimation of pollution and climate impact. So Russian Arctic take part of Arctic, you know very well. And so the important for us now is that the Russian flaring emission in North region are directly within the major low altitude pathway of subarctic air mass penetrating into Arctic. This is the most important just now motivation. So we know this one very well. And this is why just I again citing what was Matt already citing many times, flex part model simulates that gas flaring contribute around 42% of black carbon concentration. And I should say more a little bit, so it is almost from Russian north, Northern Asian part of Russia, so it is coming from. So this really almost, this is why I want to pay you now just attention on almost on Russian Arctic. So the quantification of mass concentration distribution of black carbon over Russian Arctic now just remaining as a major priority of scientific research. How we can really collect data? So you know that whatever Arctic, there is just the possibility to collect black carbon data and to estimate, for example, long transportation from any kind of emissions. So only the possibility is just to stay on to build some stations there. Or the other possibility is just to make some expedition to be there to collect some data. And so We made this field campaign, so Marine Arctic Expedition 2015, just during October 2015. So, starting from Arkhangelsk, so going just near this archipelago Novaya Zemlya, so this car straight, so going to Severnaya Zemlya. This is archipelago Severnaya Zemlya. By the way, it is really very difficult to approach this one. I can tell you that only 1,000 years ago it was discovered, this place. I also was very much surprised because here it's always ice. It's very difficult was just to approach. So it's only 100 years ago people found this place. So we went, so it took 20 days just go there and back. And around these 20, it always these 20 days we just made this measurements campaign. So measurements campaign was done on the research expedition marine ship Academic Troshnikov. So you see Troshnikov. So it is the modern icebreaker. It is research ship, so this is specially made for the expedition. So it belongs Arctic Antarctic Research Institute, which is St. Peter, just in St. Petersburg. So I'm always had been on the boat of this ship. So all pictures which you see, I take myself. So it's not from internet. So as soon as I appeared on the boat, I investigated first of all where we can find the cleanest place on the ship. Why? Because we want to collect ambient aerosol, first of all, Arctic aerosol. So we investigated the ship and definitely we find the best place to build the clean, let's say, clean air site. So here in front of the ship, then we investigated definitely the most polluted site is very close to pipe. So we also built this site here. So we built two sites, clean and pollution. And during the expedition, so we made this two sites. So we made black carbon measurement and sampling on two sites. So this is site number one, clean air, and just near exhaust. Especially to have the mobile measurements, we designed some portable tallometer. So tallometer, you know, to measure black carbon, three wavelengths. The biggest advantage of these instruments, it can work for polar climate using. So it's very low temperature, it can work also to, at that quite complicated conditions. So it was calibrated for the, it was calibrated before in just a GEV station, especially to have the intercomparison there with a network, typical network, maybe science, etalometer, if you know, just it is what is important. Then, so also on two sides, we always collect samples, so just then to have the intercomparison and to have the ideas about the cleanest, let's say, natural Arctic aerosol, and then also near exhaust, I will show you how different they are, I mean, with respect to natural real Arctic aerosol and exhaust, just to estimate the pollution one. Okay. So now I go to that, the major purpose. So the first one purpose was to make the Arctic particulate characterization. This is why we measure total PM mass concentration, light absorption, black carbon concentration, make the aerosol sampling for individual particle analysis, for water soluble, for organic compounds. This is the, let's say, typical set for the aerosol chemistry also. Today I will tell you almost about data analysis. So the first I will tell about time series of black carbon distribution over the seas. Then I will tell about FlexPAR simulations, which made every hours during the cruise. So the FlexPAR will follow the cruise always. So we will look on the correlation between black carbon surface distribution in FlexPAR, and then to on identification of the possible black carbon sources. Then we will also thinking about aerosol pollution, possible pollution in sea environment in accordance with also meteorological experience. expedition data, and a little bit about assessment of onboard ship pollution. Just you should believe me that we are talking really about Arctic aerosol to avoid any pollution. So we start just I'm start just from what's the beginning. So beginning was Arkhangelsk port. So we departure from the Arkhangelsk. So this is just River Dvina, that just in port. We started 10 October. So this is just to show you that the black carbon concentrations on two sides together until we are still stay on in the port. So quite high concentration is related. Definitely port is very polluted place. It's always. And so the concentration you can estimate it's around some, no, let's say 2000 nanogram per meter cubic. I give you this value just for assumption what in comparison what we will see after. So we are in a port start. So as soon we start, before just we start, we collect samples. Just I show you the aerosol in port. It's made from always. So this is individual particle analysis. So aerosol in port. Yeah, it's a lot of sodium chloride, sure, because just it is near sea, so inside. Big fraction of soot particles, just 50% of soot particles, so morphology, composition, totally carbon and oxide. Where from? Sure, it is port. So transportation, construction, ship emission, so quite dirty place. So you see quite a few other groups, it's almost dust. Which is just coming from around. So remember this value. Very soon we will see what's happened real in Arctic. So now we are in the port. And so we leave port. As soon we leave port, you see dramatic increase PM because it's strong emission from ship itself. So it's go out very strong emission of black carbon. As soon we start depart, just okay. So we depart. Now we are again, so we depart here, so this point just port. And so we start going. So we are going through the White Sea and then near Kola Peninsula. And you see soon we leave just Delta River, Dvina River. So the concentration of black carbon dramatically decrease. So it is very low concentration now. I just put almost all data. And so you see this concentration go down. It is around 100 here. Here, this is maybe a little bit higher near Kola Peninsula because it is very polluted area here with a lot of industry. And so then we go out. And approximately, next. Yeah. We go out here from the White Sea. Almost we could not measure any absorption. It means that it's less than 20 nanogram per meter cubic. Remember how much it was in port. So we cannot measure this one. Almost no absorption. So when we hear a little bit close one, okay, we already see. It's already 150. So we're going now in. Finally, we approach Karastrite. Karastrite, it's quite maybe polluted because if you know that the ship gate for the north way for ship. So this place, we approach 200 nanogram per meter cubic. This is quite high value. One more and I will tell you. Okay, so then after Karastrite, we are in Kara Sea. So in Kara Sea, we're increasing, and up to, oh my God, it's 350. I should remind you, if you just don't know, that background, Arctic background, it's around 10, 20 nanograms per meter cubic. So here we approach around 300, 400 nanogram per meter cubic. It's really very high. So what I made, definitely I made, I checked just air transportation from where it is from. So we are here. Yes, it is exactly from this area, from continent at that time. This area, quite big industry, a lot of sources of here. Here, for comparison, at that time on Tixi station, it was only 24 nanogram per meter. So, very high value. Then I check just map. It was 13 October. So you see, this is really red one. It is fireplaces at that time. So we now just no doubt about where this red one. This is just gas flaring almost, but what is visible at that time using this fire direction map. So we are here. So you see how many fires just coming, and so air transport was at that time here, from this direction. Okay, what then? Then we go further, so to Kara Sea, and quite long time in Kara Sea we quite polluted, let's say, and then go quite a little bit less, and this point almost already no absorption more. So one day before we approach Северная Земля, so almost no absorption. So no source, just a little bit, let's say, background. So, okay. Again, where we are now, just this point, what I told, when it just again background, zero, almost zero black carbon. So, and finally, we approach this star. This star, it is ice base Cap Baranova. This is one of the, let's say, best one. Next, high altitude Russian Arctic station. So we call this ice Baranova, Cap Baranova, ice based. So it take place on ice island Bolshevik. So this is one from the archipelago Северная Земля. So we just here and finally approach in one day, finally approach this Cap Baranova station and stay there around. So this is aerosol which we collected at that time. So why I show this one? It is the original real marine, let's say, aerosol. When we almost no absorption could measure, so no black carbon. This original Arctic aerosol marine one. So now you see it's composed almost 40% from sodium chloride. So particle looks like like this one normally. So sodium chloride, a little bit potassium, it is normal for sea. So there is also such kind of potassium quite high, also sodium marine salt, so magnesium some also marine salt, a little bit there is calcium sulfate, not big one but whatever, and very small fraction of dust, aluminium. That's all. It is marine aerosol. No absorption, no black carbon. Very good. Remember, I start from port. Remember, 50% of soot, it was in aerosol. Here, no, nothing. No carbonaceous aerosol. No group of any kind of carbon containing only particles. Just totally different aerosol, marine aerosol. So we approach Cap Baranova station. This is our station, Russian station. So we stay here around 2 days. And so then we go back. So we go back and again make the measurements. So when we are still just in the middle of the Kara Sea, we had been in storm. So the storm, I especially not remove this picture. From the database in the publication, I remove this one. But for you, I show you this one. So what it is? Because the ship is going like this one. How? Just to protect to this one. Yeah. So this is why we always being on the front, we always contaminated by plume, our plume from our exhaust, I mean ship exhaust. So soon like this one, again like this one. So wind is always changing. I mean, the plume is always changing the direction. This is why we see this one. But I wanted to show you that it is original measurements. So then I remove this one, I clean this data totally, and when flex par will running, forget about. So we remove this this part off. But I show you how it was originally happen just when you are in the sea. But it is quite reasonable to see this one, whatever. So we go then after 2 days, very bad, but whatever. So we go back just again through the Karst right. And so we are here now, just I show you. This round was around still 400 nanograms per meter cubic. So 400 is mean we are in a plume of pollution. So it is 400. So then just a little again, almost nothing in Barents Sea. And then we start go to close and close to Kola Peninsula, go to bed to White Sea, and we measure a very big growing of black carbon. So it looks like we affected very much the what is coming from, first of all, from Europe, this part, you will see. Yeah, finally, so we approach Port Arkhangelsk, it was 25th of October, so having very high black carbon back. So it is results. A little bit again about the composition of particles, because we need to know this one. So in Kara Strait, when black carbon approached 300, for comparison, we could observe quite small, but the group of 2.5% of particles contained, like I'm thinking, it should be quite similar organic or soot particles, because they contain only carbon and oxygen. Remember, I told you that background, Arctic background, never we could measure any kind of carbonaceous particles. But here in Karst, when black carbon approaches value, we could find this group of particles important. So how they looks like? So reacted sodium chloride, I should say about reacted because it is chloride decreased in comparison, total chloride decreased in comparison with sodium. So this is interesting particles having iron and nickel together. You understand what it is? Okay. So in calcium sulfate. Yeah. Okay. So flex part model was applied for this data. Also flex part model, it is dispersion model, Lagrangian particle dispersion model coupled with global emission inventory. It includes, first of all, meteorological analysis every 3 hours from European Central Medium Range weather forecast. So this model, what's this model doing also? It is simulate black carbon particles, just release into the model. And so, and then following, it's released, but not just immediately, it's released back in time, approximately 30 days. They calculate. Why? Just to identify the measure black, where the measure black carbon came from, just to estimate the emission. Yeah, emission sources and place of emission sources. What? They take into account emission fluxes from eclipse. So eclipse, it is evaluating climate, air quality impact, short life pollutant database. So version ELISA. It is exactly what Matt already told you about the data. It is a global database, emission database, where there is only one value for gas flaring. You remember what Matt showed you, green one. Yeah, always a little bit criticized this one. But it is usually that in the global database, there is only this value. Whatever there is technique, what technology, whatever the industry, whatever the source, whatever, I don't know. So everywhere, only one value. But it is what we have in database now. And so then, I should say before, FlexPart also tried to simulate some expedition data. So it was some expedition before, but the correlation was very poor. it was some other, for example, in this paper also cited many times. So they found very poor correlation between black carbon and flex power. This is why I want to emphasize now this one, that we have some more progress. Now the data from results from flex power. So the first you see this, the together what I showed you in previous one, together this is measurements. So this is real data. And this piece is just the last one day because the scale is very high if compared with this one. The resolution was around 1 minute. So now you see average 6 minutes during the whole cruise. This is real, let's say, observation data. And this is result from flex power. So what you see in black, this is still observation. They put the same in black. The other what you see in color, what it is? In color you see the black carbon simulated by flex power with respect to the aged time. So you see, for example, so blue one, it means that black carbon coming to the place where we are now, I mean, where the ship just this time, around 1 to 3 days back. So it was originated 3 days before. So almost you see brown, blue. Yeah, if you see quite brown, yeah, it looks like older. It is emitted older. So it is like age spectra of modeled black carbon from possible source, showing the contribution each day back in time, what it is. So it is like evolution here. It's here. So the most fresh blue one, the most old is now that, like stuff like this one. It is quite a little bit, almost, yeah. This is what we really have like results. And the other picture may be even much more important because they show really the source where the black carbon at the time coming to that point where it was measured. First, I should again to show you the intercomparison in general. So the black one, it is real measurements. Other color is simulation. So look here, flex power could not simulate this one because it's local pollution, first of all. We had been in a port at that time. So this one cannot. So this one also, they cannot simulate well. It was because some meteorological problem, it's not good. The other one, it's quite well. This period of time, quite well. You see quite well correspondence. So this one, we stay near Severnaya Zemlya, they can measure something, they can model, simulate still, there is some, we cannot measure something. But then one, okay, quite well correlation. This one, so in general, there is a correlation between measurements and what was simulated by flex power. Let's say in general. More details I will tell a little bit more. Now look on the composition of source. So since flex power based on Eclipse database, they include many sources, different kind. So they include biomass burning, transport sector, waste treatment, so residential, commercial sector, industrial combustion, energy production, which is almost include gas flaring. Okay, let's look which one compose the biggest fraction of that black carbon which could be observed. So I should say, looking on this picture, that energy production almost gives the biggest part of black carbon. So here in Kara Sea, when we on the way there, and here on the way back, Kara Sea, I showed you remember that we approach up to 40, 20, sometimes, yeah, here it's higher, 300, this is around 200, yeah, and so quite big amount. So energy production, including gas flaring, Other one, so this yellow, dirty yellow, yeah, brown also impact. Brown is transport sector. Transport, yeah, you know that AMAP now, AMAP is Arctic Monitoring Program, they always trust that transport impact much more Arctic than other sector. So you see that quite well. So transport, brown, yeah, transport sector, including all diesel emission, whatever transport ship emission now, just whatever. So quite well. The other source, let's say, yeah, there is also domestic. Domestic start be important when we went back to White Sea. Yeah, start to be more important than before. Yeah, domestic sector also important. Yes, this one almost the most important. Let me show you the, let's say, the best demonstration of impact from gas flaring. So what you see now, it is a simulation, flexpar simulation of retro plume. What is retro plume? So it is emission sensitivity just simulated like concentration multiply with grid emission, like they are telling. What it is? So just look. We are here. So we are receptor here, just staying, yeah, in this point. Yeah. So they calculate meteorological transportation, I mean air mass transportation, yeah, calculate and multiply on the emission grid. So if there is area here of emission, so you see it is start be in red. So it means that looking on this one, we can estimate the transport area, transport air mass transport at that time will like this one. And this one probably should be the most important emission source at that time. Exactly, when if just to look very carefully again, so they show us which one, where the source of black carbon, which we measure here, impacts the most. The could be impact, let's say, dominated. Look here, exactly, so that this part is the biggest source. Also the other source quite high light, but now this is biggest one. So they conclude from the flexpar that gas flaring emission, because this area of the biggest gas flaring emission in Siberia. So gas flaring emission from Yamal and Ханты-Мансийск region contributed strongly. So MET had been in Ханты-Мансийск. It was exposed much, probably. So at that time, we exposed much. So this part of source was very important. Also, I show you the other example, how flexpar quantifies the sources of emission when we had been back. Remember, I many times repeated that very high concentration was measured in White Sea when we come back. So at that time, you see very strong air mass, let's say, transportation and pollution coming at that point. So they really, especially for us, show us the contribution from anthropogenous black carbon at that time. So west of European, almost this one, so 10% from Ukraine and 90% from Central and Eastern Europe contributed the time to the black carbon, which was measured in that point. So this is almost anthropogenic. It's mean all source except biomass burning. Biomass burning was separate just to show, because you know that biomass burning source very important now. So you see at that time, these sources play big role in the black carbon, which we measured here. So just on the source of south of the Europe part, this source took place quite a lot. About general overview of the results. This picture is very important to show you the agreement between measured and modeled concentration of black carbon. You see the different points specially highlighted to show us quite well where it was quite well correlations and where it was not good correlations with FlexPAR. So in general, it was not bad, let's say, but they removed the points of the biggest uncertainty. And so where it was the bad, the biggest bias was here when we could not measure absorption at all, but they just simulate something. So also here, because it was very big local pollution, also there is a few points not very well. Yes, we can discuss why it is, but it is what really FlexPAR gave us with respect to uncertainty and the correlation with measured black carbon concentration. Finally, conclusion. So black carbon showed increased value from 100 to 400 nanograms in Kara C, in Kara Strait, in Kara Sea, almost near Kola Peninsula, extremely very high, 1,000 concentration in White Sea here. So FlexPAR in general quite well reproduced observed black carbon concentration, building credibility to inventory clips. Quite good agreement with the region of gas flaring, so Yamal and Ханты-Мансийск area quite well simulated, but I want also to emphasize that it was quite overestimation of flaring emission here in Nenetsk and Komi region. Yeah, it is. So near Arkhangelsk, almost surface transportation, biomass burning, residential, commercial combustion, so also gave quite big impact. So finally, we have to conclude that almost gas flaring from west of Yamal Peninsula, Komi, Nenetsk district, Ханты-Мансийск, source of Yamal Peninsula here, was dominated in to pollute Russian Arctic in October 2015. Finally, just to have the complete picture, I just show you what is happened really very close to pipe of ship, just to remove the question why we believe in our measurements that we measure really Arctic black carbon. So because we collect also some of these emissions, so near pipe, it is probably the place, the biggest pollution, sure. And I show very briefly that as just intercomparison between site number one and site number two. So site number one, it is what you already know. This is measurements, what I showed you. And if the plume coming exactly on our sampling site, we can approach the value incredible, very high, very, let's say, nothing doubt about that it was the time of pollution. So all situation like this one, we excluded from database, what you saw before, it could be just happen. So I'm always responsible for such kind of event if it is happen. And that time, just for comparison, so this emission, because we are always interested in emission, so staying here very close, we collected was 80% of soot at that time, really. And so, but we never find such kind of particles in front of ship where we measure Arctic aerosol. So I just show you to improve your believing that we made like quite correct measurements. Finally, this is paper which was done, and so it was quite well evaluated. So in environment and science technology, black carbon source concentrated by observation in Russia Arctic, it was devoted exactly what I told you about. And here, finally, I would like to thank you. If you have some questions, okay. So now I am on Khabaranov station. So in this station, just last word, we built aerosol station. So it is just now has some etalometer, have some sampling system, and we are very much happy to suggest you to think that it is very best, really best place to collect black carbon quite long time and to look on the event where we polluted by air transportation from continent, from the region of gas flaring. Then we can quantify, really very well, quantify the possible impact of anthropogenous emission and maybe just separate and really quantify the gas flaring from Russian sources. So thank you much for your attention. I think I take already much time. Everything resolved. Everything
clear. It's a long afternoon.
Jeez, oh, it is impressed you, yeah. Very much.
I've got a question. Mm-hmm. So when you were talking about how on October 25th, the emission rates were much higher versus, say, when you left, is that because, like, suddenly everybody put on their heaters or something? You know what I mean? Like the weather changed or something? Like, in other words, why was it so different in the same spot between the 13th and the 25th?
Yeah, because the air transportation, meteorological system, always changing, wind direction is always changing. It's real, let's say, real observations. It's like in your city, it's always changing. You see, you know, even just during this day, it's already haze. In the morning, now it is haze and rain. So it is only because the transportation, air transportation is changing. Weather is changing, transportation is changing. This is why we catch this event. If it is not, so everything what we observed is just because the different air transportation. When we see, when we saw almost nothing black carbon, it means that almost air transport from Arctic Ocean. If we see some transport, if we see increase of black carbon, so we see, maybe I should put also picture. If we have the air transportation from continent, so we have the high black carbon pollution. And that it is what you asked about. It is exactly what happened, that at that time when we arrived, if we arrived maybe 1-2 days before, we could measure this one. But we arrived at this day, and the day was, it is exactly was like this one. Maybe if is that day, I don't know, air coming from like this one or like this one, we should measure almost, yeah, maybe just 100, 200. But at that time, you see, we could catch this like event. It just happened. This is why what I'm telling that, yeah, expedition is best, but it is very suddenly something, it is not predictable. You are just measured and you don't know what has happened. It is maybe happen, maybe you are happy to get pollution, maybe not, who knows. So this is why, and this is why we have to measure with high resolution, but whatever. It has happened like this one. This is why I think staying on the station is much better. You continuously running, continuously collecting data. If effective plume is coming from continent, you measure high concentration. If coming from Arctic Ocean, it can be very low. So this is possibility to really to have the picture long time. This is very good idea. So this is just what's happened. We report what has happened. Mm-hmm.
I may have missed when you said this, but so do you have someone at the station of the island I can't remember the name of? Like if you're the station you built?
Cape Baranova. It's Cape Baranova. Yeah, it's.
I'm not going to say. So do you go back and collect samples or is it streaming?
This station is operating now continuously, fortunately. And so I have very good collaboration with Arctic Antarctic Institute, and there is a team. They are very much interesting. We are working always together. And so there is always somebody who just staying on the station. And to collect samples, he is going there. It's around, you saw, 1 kilometer from. Because we wanted to avoid, all with a gun. Yeah, it is original. Go there to change samples, to change samples, to collect samples, to change the talometer, filter, and collect samples. For me, yeah. Yeah, but I still not analyze them. Very busy. Yeah, very quick, very difficult situation. Там not so simple. But I think it is one of the, let's say, example of very big yeah, challenge now. Yeah, but we hope to have the data very much. But still not always all problem resolved, I think, with but can be done, I hope. Because station should be operated. It is the best now, the possibility. Very clean, nothing around. It is good.
Do you know if, I know there's multiple GAW labs around the Arctic. Do they all collect particle samples, or are they?
Who collect?
Where you calibrated your, say the GAW?
Yes.
There's multiple labs in the Arctic that.
No, I calibrated talometer just using my very good collaboration with my Greek colleagues. So they have GAV station in Athens. Just I bring my talometer to put together with Maggie Science AE33, because it's best instrument now, and just in running 3 months just to collect data and calibrate this one. So what the data we put this one, we always treat this data together to looking on the what is AE33 gives us. Because we have to compare, we cannot not compare. We have to compare with something. Yeah, sure, it has to be calibrated.
Yeah, I was wondering if the ethylometer or the particle samples, is that a standard protocol at other Arctic research stations?
You mean about black carbon intercomparison and measurements?
Yeah,
in Arctic societies, there is very big efforts about because quite different station, Alert, Barrow, yeah, a lot of many just Nialysand in Spitsbergen and Tixi in Russia, they have quite different instrument. This is big problem. Someone have etalometer, the other one SP2, the other one have some PICs. Yeah. So now they have very big efforts to make this intercomparison, to build, let's say, one protocol, to build approach how to intercalibrate the different instrument. And finally, to have the value, the common value, how to correlate between. So it is still on this activity. But what is enough at least to report that we used, they used some kind of instrument, because each instrument is quite known that each instrument has its own MAC, yeah, mass absorption coefficient, which translates the absorption value to absorption coefficient to black carbon. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Olga. I really appreciate you coming. Yeah. Thank you to anybody else who's still online for joining us, and thank you for all coming on a Friday afternoon. Have a great weekend.